Good evening, Rowan. It's the 22nd of July 2018, and it's about 7:30. And obviously this is my usual Sunday evening video, resuming once again after a little break due to mobile phone technical difficulties. So I didn't really have anything to make and edit videos on. So this is my usual Sunday evening video to reassure you that I haven't been seducing any priests over the weekend or hanging round the Catholic parish of St Urban's hoping to bump into any pretend astrophysicists in order to save your skin. And I haven't come out as a lesbian either in order to save your gigantic ego. And I haven't done any of those things since my last video when I was assuring you I wouldn't be doing any of those things. So first of all, I thought I could wish you a happy anniversary because today is actually 3 years since I moved into this flat. And that was after you'd had me thrown out of my house on the 9th of July 2015. And I spent a night on a park bench and some time in a homeless shelter. And then I moved in here. So we've got so many anniversaries of the things that you've afflicted me with that it's hard to keep up with them all. But there you are, there's another one. So, after wishing you happy anniversary, I thought we could have a look at this photo here, which was taken on the 20th of July 2018. And the reason we're going to have a look at this photo is because you're wearing sandals. You're showing off your feet. So I thought we could have a look at them. Well, why not? So let's zoom in. Here we are. Here are the feet. Yes. They're not the most photogenic of feet, are they? Really? But another thing I'd like to point out, if we look at the back of your sandal here, it looks like you do in fact wear shoes that are too big for you. So you are a fraud, as I'd always suspected. That's hilarious. So moving on from that, I'm going to talk again now about the dialogue that you were in on the 5th of July 2018. The details of that will be up on the screen when I show the clip of you speaking. So I'm talking about a 3-minute clip this evening. I've done a video commentary on it already, which will be later in this video. But there's just two particular statements that you make that I want to say something more about. So here's the first one. So you say, the body. Now, I would like to mention that every time you mention the body in this clip that I'm going to show, you really emphasise it. It's quite astonishing. I mean, you really, really emphasise it, but you'll see that later on anyway. So, the body is a project, a collaborative venture. So I'd just like to reiterate for the million zillionth time that my body is not a collaborative venture. It belongs to me and I decide whether anyone else has access to it and whether anyone else's opinion about it is relevant. So you are a completely irrelevant person to me. You're absolutely nothing to do with me. You've got a fantasy relationship with me in your head because you're a complete lunatic. And so my body is not a collaborative venture. I mean, it's just a complete nonsense, this statement, anyway. The body is a project, a collaborative venture. And you're saying all of this in such an authoritative way as well, as if it were absolute truth and nobody can dispute it. You're gaslighting again. I've talked about your gaslighting in previous videos, but I mean, it's like Jabberwocky again, or Virgon poetry or something. I've talked about you speaking in this way before. It's like nonsense speech, like a word salad. It doesn't even mean anything. And you do tend to talk in this very authoritative way when you're making nonsense statements, and that's what all of this is. It's hard to imagine why you were considered to be such a fantastically intelligent person, a genius, when you talk nothing but crap in an authoritative manner. The body is a project, a collaborative venture. What does that even mean? It doesn't even mean anything. The body is a project, a collaborative venture, almost made up of what I'm aware of from one irreducible perspective, which is the fact that I'm it. You're it, are you? You certainly think you're it. Which is the fact that I'm it, and the perception and reflection that comes to me, and as I've sometimes said to people when talking about this, the fact is that I can't see the back of my head. Well, let's look at that statement. I can't see the back of my head. Well, you can see the back of your head, Rowan. So this is a false statement. I don't know how you've lived to be nearly 70 years old and you still haven't figured out how to look at the back of your head. This might go some way to explaining why you've got such a terrible hairstyle. That you haven't figured out yet how to look at the back of your head. So it's very easy to do, and you can do it with two mirrors. And people often do this when they're styling their hair. So I used to style my hair as a teenager. So I learned this when I was quite young, that you can look at the back of your head by using two mirrors. So you've either got two fairly large mirrors positioned in such a way that you're looking in one. And when you look in the first mirror, you're looking at the reflection of the back of your head in the other mirror, which can't be directly behind you, otherwise your head would be in the way and you wouldn't be able to see it. So you have to have it set off to the side a little bit at an angle, and then you can see the back of your head in that mirror. And the other way of doing it is to hold a small mirror around the back of your head again at an angle, and that way you can see the back of your head. So I don't know why you haven't figured out yet that you can see the back of your head. The fact is, I can't see the back of my head. Now, the second thing that's astonishing about this statement, first, it's false. You can see the back of your head with the help of mirrors or with the camera on a mobile phone. You can see the camera on a mobile phone and a mirror, you can see the back of your head that way. I suppose you could get a drone to fly around the back of your head and film the back of your head as well. So there's quite a few ways you can actually see the back of your head. So this statement is false, as I've said. But the other thing that's astonishing about it, despite the fact that it's false, I mean, in addition to the fact that it's false, is that it's of no significance whatsoever. So, what difference does it make to anything whether you can see the back of your head or not? So, you're making this statement, as I'm going to come on to in a minute, as if it was some profound significance to something. So, it just doesn't make any difference to anything. It's got no philosophical impact at all that you can't see the back of your head. You don't even need to see the back of your head. You could live your whole life without seeing the back of your head, and your life wouldn't be diminished in any way whatsoever. Your quality of life, the length of your life, your health, nothing at all is going to be diminished by the fact that you couldn't see the back of your head, even though you can see the back of your head. So it's of no significance whatsoever, and nothing can be concluded from it either, but you're trying to make out that it can. So the fact is, I can't see the back of my head. If I'm going to learn about the back of my head, I need somebody else to tell me. Well, no, you don't, because you can see the back of your head anyway. But even if you did need somebody else to tell you what the back of your head looked like, What relevance is that to anything anyway? And for example, say I asked you, what does the back of my head look like? You lie about everything, so I couldn't rely on what you said. I mean, you might say, well, it's blonde, even though it's brown, my hair. You'd probably say, well, your hair at the back of your head is blonde and it's got purple streaks in it or something like that, which would be a complete lie. So if you wanted someone to explain to you what the back of your head looked like, it would need to be someone you could trust to be telling the truth, wouldn't it? And you're not such a person. So we really can't deduce anything from the fact that we can't see the back of our heads without using mirrors or cameras or whatever, or asking someone to explain it to us. It's just complete and utter nonsense. It's of no relevance to anything whatsoever. But you're talking about it as if it's proving a point, and it isn't. So so if I'm going to learn about the back of my head, I need somebody else to tell me. That's putting it very crudely, but the body image, emphasising body again in a weird way, but the body image is something we work on together and learn together. So this is really, really creepy, I think. And you're saying it, as I've mentioned, in such an authoritative way, like it's an indisputable fact and we just can't get away from it. And it's complete and utter nonsense. And what do you even mean by body image anyway? Do you mean like the way we look or the way we think about the way we look? Or do you mean how we as people are related to our bodies, whether we're the same thing as our body or whether we're our body is just a part of us? Or what does this even mean? So the body image is something we work on together and learn together. Well, in relation to anything at all, not just body image, there's no point working on it with you or learning anything with you, because as I've said, you're lying all the time, and you also, you live in a fantasy world, and if anything that you say happens to be true or real, that's merely a coincidence that reality for once coincided with your fantasy world. And so my final point on this as well is that my body is not something we work on together or learn together. There is no way. You've got a fantasy relationship with me in your head. You're a complete nutcase. You're a stalker. You're a sexual predator. And I'm absolutely nothing to do with you. It's all in your head. You live in a fantasy world, as I've said. So my body image, emphasis on body there, is not something we work on together and learn together, because there is no way. It's all in your head. So zip your trousers up and fuck off. You're a complete nutcase. Anyway, that's the end of what I'm saying about that part of it. So there's just one other thing I want to make a comment about. And this is where you're talking about the location of the statue that you're talking about, or the artwork. So the artwork that you're talking about here is the shape of a man's body, which is made up of nails that were taken from the roof of Canterbury Cathedral when it was being renovated. And they're very old nails, and they're all handcrafted nails, not factory produced. So there's this man's body made out of nails, handmade nails, and it's hanging in Canterbury Cathedral, this artwork. So that's what you're talking about. And you're talking about the location of it, because first of all, the chair of this discussion, he says that the impact of this artwork wouldn't be the same if it was in an art gallery. And you basically say, I'm paraphrasing here, this isn't a quotation, that it would be largely the same, but you say that it's significant locating it where the body of Thomas Becket was laid. So Thomas Becket is a former Archbishop of Canterbury from the 12th century who was martyred by the king's soldiers in Canterbury Cathedral. So that's who Thomas Becket is, and that's where he's buried there in Canterbury Cathedral. So locating it where the body of Thomas Becket was laid, that's quite significant. And you then say, this is the thing I want to make a comment about, and a few yards from where the living body of Christ is reserved. So that's quite interesting, because you were going to say a few hundred yards from where the living body of Christ is reserved, but you changed it to a few yards. So the living body of Christ is reserved in the Catholic Church, isn't it? That's why you were going to say a few hundred yards from where the living body of Christ is reserved. But you then realised that the Anglican elements of the Eucharist are reserved in Canterbury Cathedral, so you changed it to a few yards. So if I believed in Sigmund Freud, I'd think that was a Freudian slip. You give yourself away all the time. So, as I've mentioned previously, when the bread and the wine are consecrated in a Catholic Mass, the Catholic Church teaches that these become literally the body and blood of Christ, only maintaining the appearance of bread and wine. But in the Church of England, in the 39 Articles of the Church of England, they have a receptionist doctrine around the Eucharist, which means that the presence of Christ in the elements of the Eucharist, in the bread and the wine, is dependent on the state of the soul of the person receiving it. It does also say elsewhere in the 39 Articles that the elements of the Eucharist, after they've been consecrated, they're not meant for looking at or for processing around. So I think this is why you were making, let's call it a Freudian slip here, a few hundred yards from where the living body of Christ is reserved, i.e., in the Catholic Church. That's what you were thinking about when you said that and had to correct yourself hastily. Anyway, that's the end of my video for today. I must say, I've enjoyed not making any videos because it's lovely not thinking about you and thinking about my beloved all the time. He's just so wonderful, and we're made for each other, and we just can't wait to be together on our bed of roses, on our silk sheets, having a really good time in each other's arms, resisting tyrannous authorities. So while we're still looking forward to that, you need to be alert because I will be turning up to make a citizen's arrest for terrorism and also to ask you those awkward questions I've still got up my sleeve. Hasta la próxima.
Not nothing is just a thing hanging Canterbury Cathedral, because what you've said about the relation of this to meditation, Vipassana in particular, the idea there that you have to get rid of the notion that the self is a thing, is a solid thing.
What did you say? Oh, you're breaking up on me. Sorry, I cannot hear you. I'm kind of busy.
You have to get rid of the notion that the self is a thing, is a solid thing. You can only talk about what sits on the cushion, the point of orientation. Somebody else put it, that's where we begin. The body is a project, it's a collaborative venture almost.
Give it up.
Is a project, it's a collaborative venture almost, made up of what I'm aware of from one irreducible perspective, which is the fact that I am it, and the perception and reflection that comes to me.
Oh! Oh, yes! 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 Oh! Yes! 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 Oh! Oh! Oh!
I'll have what she's having.
I am it, and the perception and reflection that comes to me, and as I've sometimes said to people when talking about this, the fact is I can't see the back of my head. If I'm going to learn about the back of my head, I need somebody else to tell me.
What's up, guys? Fighterverse TV here, and today we are going to learn how to look at the back of your head in the mirror. So, first step of all, stand behind the mirror like this. So, step two, raise the phone upwards like this. And then you can see the whole back of your head, like this. Okay? Gonna wash that man right out of my hair.
Gonna wash that man right out of my hair. The fact is I can't see the back of my head. If I'm going to learn about the back of my head, I need somebody else to tell me. Mm. That's putting it very crudely, but it does mean that the body image, is something we work on together and learn together. Crudely, but it does mean that the body image, is something we work on together and learn together. Mm. And therefore, the notion that the bodily world or the material world is, as some people like to think of it, a large cupboard full of solid lumps. And therefore, the notion that the bodily world or the material world is, as some people like to think of it, a large cupboard full of solid lumps is the worst way we could possibly approach the material world.
And here was I thinking that this would be a theological given that you talk about nails in terms of crucifixion or violation. There is an element of violation, of internal, external, but you're talking more in terms of dialogue, Anthony. But of course, context fundamentally changes the way this piece is. If this was shown in a white-walled gallery, it would read differently, significantly differently to its suspension of
I don't know that it would read significantly differently. There would be resonances and echoes absent. This time I broke this world, I'm over the whole goddamn chicken side. I ain't gonna put my tip in that hole yet. I'm gonna go get England and try and rip it wider. Oh. There would be resonances and echoes absent because locating it, as Anthony says, where the body of Thomas Becket was laid, and a few yards from where the living body of Christ is reserved. There would be resonances and echoes absent because locating it, as Anthony says, where the body of Thomas Becket was laid, and a few yards from where the living body of Christ is reserved.
With the fabric of the building.
Of the building. Yes, you know, that does give you a few extra.
I've got a lot to work with there, actually, didn't I?
But there's something about the nature of the image, and of course we'll see it with other images, which provokes some of the same challenges. We'll see it with other images, which provoke some of the same challenges, some of the same, harmonics, let's say.
The wise men came, so stern and strict, and brought the order to evict. You'd better get born in some place else, so move along, get along, move along, get along, go. Move, shift.
That night when the Lord came home, inquiring of his lady, oh. The servant said on every hand, she's gone with the raggle-taggle gypsies, oh.
The footman memorized the number, but the prince still holds both the slippers. And would you leave a palace for a bed, sits and canterbury tales?
Oh, what care I for my house and my land? What care I for my money? Oh, I'd rather have a kiss from the wild gypsy's lips.
I'm away with the raggle-taggle
gypsy. I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy. Oh.